and welcome back to Neighbors to Know. I'm your host, Jen Pula, and today we have a neighbor also from Boston, and ironically, who is married to the last neighbor that we had on Neighbors to Know, which was Jana Scholten, that was just on, seems like 5 minutes ago. So we're in a new year, we're here for new possibilities, and our neighbor today has a lot of stuff to share with us about his journey and sharing, and some really important take-homes for starting, especially off this for this new year, about like waking up to, you know, anything that could be true for you, waking up to leading a life that's fulfilling and inspiring to you, and whatever that might look like. So I'd like to introduce you to Dan Junkins. Hi, Dan.
Hi.
I'm inspired just by how I started that.
That was great. Thank you so much.
Thanks for being here, Dan.
You're welcome.
And yeah, so we'll start off by, you know, tell us a little bit about who you are. And yeah, let's start off by who you are.
So my name is Dan Junkins. As you know, I live with my wife, Jana Scholten, in Boston. We've been living there since 2005. We have two cats. I grew up in Western Massachusetts. I grew up in Deerfield. And my father was an academic. My mother was an artist. So I was around a lot of artwork and a lot of stories and storytelling and poems. Grew up with two parents that kind of doted on us. So they read stories to us in bed. They sang songs to us. They just were very involved with us as kids growing up. And I grew up in the late 60s and 70s. Went to Deerfield Academy because I was a local kid from the town of Deerfield. I was what they called at the school, they called me Dago because I was a day student. So that was the play on the word. But so that was my sort of growing up.
Well, when you say storytelling, was it storytelling like about your family and their experiences, or was it like a fantasy storytelling?
It was like fantasy storytelling. Like, my mother got me involved with Greek mythology in sixth grade. I read all the Greek myths. I mean, I became like this voracious reader of stories, but they would tell us all these stories at nighttime, going to bed. So that was sort of that experience sort of got me into reading books and really sort of resonating with stories and storytelling. I think it also started my eclectic path of jobs.
That's a
jobs,
great word.
You know?
You've had some pretty unique, cool jobs.
Yeah. I worked for 14 years at the Yankee Candle Company. I was the last hand dipper of candles there, and I was the first machine operator. And then I landed a fascinating job in the store itself, in what they called the Candle Making Museum, where we shared about the history of candles and candle making. We were dressed in the outfits of the 1700s as a candle maker and doing demonstrations and sharing with people about candles and making them by hand. So that was a lot of fun.
You worked on a boat?
I did. I worked on a boat for a year. I worked on a schooner off the coast of Maine as a deckhand, but also did a lot of woodworking for the boat, too. So it was a lot of prep work to get the boat in the water. But that was an amazing learning experience. Part of that was due to my family vacationing on an island off the coast of Maine, and they had a sailboat, and we used to spend months trying to get the boat in the water. So I ended up fulfilling a fantasy of mine of being a deckhand, and I did that for a while, but then had to get to make some money because I wasn't making any money there. But
well, that's great about the storytelling, that you have your mind open to all these different things, like, you know, I could be Zeus. And
yeah, right, exactly.
I could live in the water with my trident, and, you know,
yeah.
You don't know.
And in a lot of ways, I mean, there was one night where there was a storm where the captain called me. The boat was docked in the water, but it was like almost a semi-hurricane, and he had me go down there because I only lived 400 yards away, and we literally were like fighting the water, the wind, and everything to try and make sure the boat wasn't damaged in any way. And that was really actually scary, but exciting in a lot of ways. I know that sounds crazy.
Well, it's exciting to me.
For me.
If land would be nearby.
I was on the deck, you know.
Okay.
Yeah, right.
As long as you're docked and you know that you at least get a rope to get to dry land. And,
yes.
You know, cover.
Yes. And so, interestingly, I went from that to a couple of odd jobs along the way and then ended up with a chimney sweep company. So for another 14 years, I worked as in the chimney sweep company, first as an actual chimney sweep for about 4 years, and then I went and began managing the company from the office and then doing sales from the office.
I'm going to go back to my fantasy land of your story, because Mary Poppins is one of my most favorite books and movies.
It's so funny that you say that, because as a little boy, my mother had me watch Mary Poppins.
Really?
At the age of like 3 or 4. And I fell in love with Julie Andrews. And where we were living at that point, there was a neighbor across the street who was the spitting image of Julie Andrews.
Interesting.
And so during the day, I would meander. I was like 2 or 3. I'd meander over to her doorstep and literally sit on the doorstep waiting for her to come out. And she would call my mother and say, Marty, your son is at my doorstep. And so she'd have to come across the street and grab me and bring me back.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Is that why you wanted to be a chimney sweep?
Yeah,
that's
I think
awesome.
So. Yeah. To be like Bert, I think
is
his name,
Bert.
Right?
Yep.
Yeah, so.
So what does that look like a day, really briefly, because that's not the crux of why we're here, but I'm just intrigued by the chimney sweep thing, because I am visualizing right now them dancing on the rooftops with their, I don't even know what they're called, you know, the broomy thing.
The chimney
with
brush.
Yeah.
Yep,
so like
sweep.
Really briefly, like a day in the life of a chimney sweep in 30 seconds.
Well, we literally would show up at the office and get our itinerary for the work. They usually book like 4 or 5 visits to 4 or 5 different houses. Mm-hmm. We actually would show up at the house in a van, dressed in a black pants, regular black shirt, looking like a utility guy, you know, and then basically set up in front of the fireplace with a drop cloth, with a vacuum, with brushes.
So very much Mary Poppins so far.
Kind of.
Yeah.
But
in,
interestingly enough, we were booked a lot more for cleaning the chimneys for oil heating systems and gas heating systems.
Oh, okay.
So we were doing more work there than to fireplaces, because there's not a lot of people who are actually burning fires in fireplaces anymore, or even wood stoves. So the majority of our work was actually cleaning those chimneys. So we bumped into oil guys and plumbers a lot, and they were constantly calling us to resolve issues for heating systems that were not necessarily with the heating system, but with the chimney. So, and we did a lot of repair work on the chimneys themselves too. So that was sort of, and then we would write up a report, give it to the customer, review it with them, tell them what's going on.
And then go on the rooftops and start dancing,
we
get the penguins and cue the song.
Right. And we even, you know, there was a mantra during the job where they said, you always have to get up on the roof no matter what. And, but there were certain days when we couldn't do that. But
just to see, or why?
It was basically designed to inspect the chimney above the roof, because it's exposed to the weather, so it usually there's deterioration there, and we want to diagnose it. The downside was is that in the wintertime here in New England, it's kind of rough, you know, with snow and ice. And I stupidly did it one time, got up on the roof and slipped.
Oh.
Fell off the roof, but thank God there had been a blizzard the day before, and there was like 3 feet of snow, and I went right into this big fluffy snow pile. Lucky.
That's a good way to have that story end.
Yes. So
it's cool that your family opened up, you know, this world of storytelling, and it's, you know, as you're going from all these different things in storytelling. So what was after the chimney sweep?
So after the chimney sweep, I actually it was not. I ended the job because I was diagnosed with leukemia. And it came out of the blue. And one of the reasons that I didn't go back to the job was that the leukemia diagnosis was like a revelation for me. So it, what happened was I thought I just had the flu. And after a week, I thought I felt better. And I went back that one day, and I just started sweating while I was at work, and I just thought, wow, this is not right. So I went back home, and I was making enough money to pay the bills, but we were sort of between a rock and a hard place financially, because we actually couldn't afford the insurance plans that the state of Massachusetts was offering. I know that they make it available for everybody, but those insurance plans can be hefty if you're not with a large company. This is a very small company, and they weren't required to actually give us insurance. So we were flying without insurance. So it was a huge risk. Mm-hmm. And the job had become sort of labor, like work, like dull. It was now going to an office, sitting in front of a computer, making phone calls. And it, being someone who's a story, loves storytelling, I really needed something that filled me up and made me excited and passionate. That did not.
Your face just totally changed when you started talking about that sitting in front of a computer, because you're all, you were smiley anyway, but your face just kind of got
and
like that, you
and
know?
It was like that. It really was like that. And so Jana basically encouraged me to go to a doctor, mm-hmm. and we paid out of pocket. The doctor saw me, and the first thing he said was, I want to have your blood tested. I looked white as a ghost. And so I went home, having not knowing what the results would be, but I woke up the next day feeling energized. I don't know if it had something to do with like having gone to a doctor.
Yeah, the white coat thing.
Right.
Yeah, everything's fine just because you went.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I started to go out the door, and I got a phone call, and I got a phone call from the head lab, blood lab technician. And he said, are you Dan Junkins? And I said, yes. He goes, you got to get yourself to an ER, like right now. I'm like, why? He goes, your blood levels are so low. He said, you know, you've got to have somebody take a look at it. He goes, I know you're probably on your back right now. I said, no, I actually feel fine. He went, that's impossible. That's impossible. He said, you've got to get yourself to an ER now. So we went to the ER.
You were still working as a, were you doing the management side of the?
I was doing the management side of the okay. company at this point. So I called in, told him I wouldn't show up at work. Went to the ER, and it was Beth Israel. The reason why I bring it up is because Beth Israel is a learning hospital. Mm-hmm. So whenever there's a nurse or a doctor that visits you, there's usually two or three other people. They're usually residents in training or nurses that are in training. And so a nurse, lead nurse showed up, and she said, we do see that your levels are low, but we also see an anomaly. And it looks very similar to leukemia. And when I heard that word, I was just like, what?
I think a child, you weren't a child, obviously. That,
no.
Yeah, because I think of leukemia as a child-based, and that's my own not knowing, but well, I link that to be a child-based cancer.
That's an accurate assessment. So the particular leukemia that I was diagnosed with was what they call acute myeloid leukemia, and it usually attacks very young children or very old people. Mm-hmm. So I was 54 at the time. And so they considered me young. I really wanted to hang out with them more because they kept calling me young. You know?
Yes, I am.
And, right. So they wanted to find out more. But what was so different about Beth Israel that really sort of made me enjoy being with them was that they were relating to me like a partner. Like they would ask questions, they would be inquisitive, there was no commands coming out of their mouths, because that's usually how most nurses and doctors have talked to me, but mm-hmm. that didn't happen there. And I found out that it's a learning hospital, so they interact with people in a different way, they get trained and educated in a different way, and it was really, I was actually quite, I don't know, comforted is, I guess, the best word to say.
Because you're not on your own?
That's how it felt. Like, as surprising as it would be for some people to hear the word leukemia, for me personally, there was this comfort level with them, because in a lot of ways, it kind of reminded me of being with my parents, because they were at my level a lot of the times, talking to us, doing storytelling as a young child. So in a way, it was kind of like that. It was like one of those adults, but they're talking at your level, like they're not talking down to you or giving you a command or telling you what to do.
This is how your story is going now.
You know?
Like you have these eclectic jabs, and that's your story, and now your story includes this. So it's interesting when you said the connection between your parents.
Yeah.
Now you have them, they're part of your story.
Yes.
Where's the story going to go?
It was like an immediate sort of family relationship started building, like, immediately. And throughout that first day being in the ER, I had multiple doctors and nurses coming and visiting me, asking me questions, wanting to know about my lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And I was sharing with them about my stories and life and everything.
I'm Bert from Mary Poppins. And
yeah.
Well, was there some, I don't know, was there some relation? I imagine you're exposed to a ton of chemicals, you know, being in chimneys.
Yeah, I was. It wasn't as much as you might think, though. I mean, they had gravitated away from doing any heavy chemicals when I was there. Mm-hmm. So I'm not quite sure what the cause of it is. I know that one potential cause of leukemia is the exposure to benzene, but I'd like to know how many young children are exposed to benzene. Or
what is benzene in?
That you find like in creosote or in other liquid, very sort of hazardous materials.
Hmm. That's interesting. Because as a kid, like, why would you be around that?
Yeah, or nuclear radiation, or maybe I was, I don't really know, honestly. But they still don't know as well. Most people do say that they have not yet been able to understand what's the source of leukemia. It could be hereditary, mm-hmm. but there's no history of it in my family on either side, my mother's or my father's.
I find that with so many cancers, too, because you could have someone who's never smoked a cigarette in their life, and then they have lung cancer. And then you have someone who's smoked, a pack a day for 40 years, and then nothing happens.
Right.
I almost feel like there's no rhyme or reason.
Right.
Which hopefully they'll figure out as time and research goes on. And then you have Jana. I don't know what the timeline was of that, but then Jana was diagnosed with MS.
That was like 20 years prior.
Okay.
So, but what the great thing for me was discovering, I was with her in her healing process, and so I knew a lot about meditation. I was aware of, we were eating a plant-based diet. I was a long-distance runner. That was my sport growing up. I was also a wrestler. So I was very active athletically growing up, and so I was a pretty healthy guy. So the doctors and nurses were intrigued that I had a lot of healthy habits, so to speak. So for me, it was really inspiring to sort of keep getting feedback from them, because they kept saying I was young. I was like, keep saying that. I like that. But also it was discovering that I was on my own, and I felt free for the first time in 14 years from this job that I didn't know was kind of taking me down, like emotionally and spiritually. I just didn't feel fulfilled. And it was like sort of in that hospital where I'm like, God, I don't think I'm gonna be going back to that for a while, and I'm not sure I really want to. And I really feel like I've got this huge burden lifted immediately. Hmm. Surprisingly, and I felt like these doctors and nurses said, you're a young prospect for this type of leukemia, and their prognosis looks pretty good. So we think that we could help you, and we're just wanting your permission. And they kept asking for my permission. I'm like, hell yeah, of course, mm-hmm.
So you were on a similar path with how Jana went about her treatment with...
Well, I was living the same kind of lifestyle. Yes, absolutely.
And
I was taking on the meditation with her. So it's intriguing that she had a chronic condition that she healed herself from. And I just, within a day, I was thinking, God, if she could heal herself, I can heal myself. Especially the positive feedback I was getting from the doctors and nurses. I will say that after the whole process and everything, months later, they did confide in me that I had about 2 to 3 weeks left. which was a real shock.
And they didn't tell you that?
They didn't tell me that right away. Well, they did not want to hit me with that. Yeah. So in a lot of ways, I have an immense amount of respect and admiration for the way they handled that conversation. It really seemed to me like they were really very listening. They were listening oriented, so to speak, and really were interested in making sure that they spoke in a particular way that didn't impact me in some way. So I enjoyed it immensely, surprisingly. I know it sounds crazy to a lot of people out there, but for me in the moment, it was inspiring to sort of be around these kind of people that really were about caring. And I have to say that both Jan and I dabble in a lot of alternative medicine. Mm-hmm. So we had a sort of prejudiced, skeptical viewpoint of Western medicine, and my experience there really had me recognize that medicine is medicine, no matter what, whether it's Western, Eastern, alternative, whatever. You know, everybody is committed to people's health and well-being. Mm-hmm. That's really what I got, and it was really inspiring that way.
What was the Western medicine part?
Well, the Western medicine part was I was then prescribed the most powerful chemotherapy protocol in all the cancers out there. I didn't know that till afterwards, thank God. I'm glad I didn't. But it was basically an IV of 12 straight days of two types of chemotherapy, one of which had a nickname called the Red Devil. That's nice.
Yeah.
And they would walk in. The nurses walked in looking like they had hazmat suits on whenever they came in with the chemo, and I'm like, okay.
So that they're not exposed to anything.
Right. So, I mean, it was a little shocking in the moment, but they kept saying to me that someone your age with your physical background and your health and well-being, we think that you can take this. Mm-hmm. I found out that many people diagnosed with this same kind of cancer, this leukemia, they have to actually rehab them before they can be exposed to any chemo. They have to, sometimes they're an organ failure, mm-hmm. and they actually have to put them through a rehab process for months at a time before they can actually start them. So I feel incredibly lucky that I was able to do this process and be strong enough to do it. And I was inspired in the moment, like on the third day that I was there was when the chemo was going to start on the fourth day. And it was still daunting, the whole notion. I say it rather cavalierly that, you know, it was okay and everything. But that third day, there was something that prompted me to discover a story that I visited a few years earlier on the internet, which intrigued me, and I thought, God, I gotta try and find it. And I remember it said the Hindu paths to life. Mm-hmm. And it was really intriguing. It was only like three paragraphs. And it took me 2 hours, but I found it. I had my laptop at the hospital. And it's just these four distinct spiritual paths in the Hindu religion that really resonated with me, and you'll know why at the end. But basically, the quick summary is the first path, it's like a metaphor for life. So the first path is that if someone is walking down a path and they come across a poisonous plant, what do? You remove the plant. And similar to life, if you come across a problem, you remove the problem. And that's one way to live life. You're constantly removing problems. The second path is the path of someone who doesn't just try and fix the problem, but resolves it. So it's getting to the root of the plant and removing the roots as well. So you get to the source of the problem, you can resolve it so it doesn't come back again. Mm-hmm. The third path is the path of doctors. Doctors can actually transform the poison into medicine and help people. And I was like, that's inspiring. Mm-hmm. That's really inspiring. But the fourth path was the one that was the most mysterious and amazing, which is the path of the peacock. And I'm like, what? So the peacocks, and I didn't believe it at first, but it said peacocks eat poison. as food.
What kind of poison?
They eat poisonous plants, and they eat poisonous, they kill and eat poisonous snakes.
Really? Is that their sole
That's their
diet?
Food. That's not just their sole diet, but it's like dessert for them.
Interesting.
So I was just blown away by this. And what peacocks do is they transform that into these gorgeous colors. And they live this thriving life. But they thrive on poison. And I just, it just resonated. I mean, it was like this moment of like, something popped inside me. Like all of a sudden I went, okay, I can eat the chemo.
Because, I mean, from what I understand, it's like that's poisoning.
It is.
It's, I mean, it's getting rid of the good and the bad.
Totally. It wipes everything out. So they basically predicted and told me, you know, I'm going to lose all my hair. I'm going to lose weight. I'm going to lose my taste buds. I'm going to lose my sense of smell. And what happened was I did lose the hair, but I gained 30 pounds. I couldn't stop eating. I actually had no issue with my stomach. They told me I would have stomach aches and stomach issues, and I actually gained 30 pounds while I was going through the most powerful chemotherapy protocol at Beth Israel.
Did you have a strong stomach going into all? I mean, that's
Jana says know. That I have got the stomach of like a horse who can eat anything, you know.
Yeah.
But they were so amazed. They actually wanted to start. They wanted to give me a shot for other medication, for basically hoping that my blood sugar wasn't going up. I'm like, stop, please. You don't need to give me any more drugs.
Right.
I'll manage this, okay? If that's your concern, I'll manage it. But so I thought that was intriguing, and I also had no issues with my gut or anything with that as well. I mean, it did wipe out all of my white blood cells. I mean, and what they would do is they would expose me for like 10 days of chemo, and then I would be there for 2 or 3 more weeks to build up my white blood cells on my own.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would go home for a week, and then they would have me come back, and I would go through it again. And go through the whole process again. So I did it 4 times.
Just over a long period of time, it seems like, if you put it all together.
It was about 6 months. They were actually scheduled to do it a 5th time, but part of the problem is that the body will just start popping fevers. I just started popping fevers. And at a certain point, in my mind, I'm like, I don't need a 5th round. I didn't say it to them, but I was about to. And then my doctor came to me and said, I don't think we need to do a 5th round. I'm like, perfect.
Because you were worn down or because?
The body is completely worn down.
Okay.
And this is what they call, I forget the exact word, but it's designed to, I was actually in remission after 10 days in the hospital, the first 10 days, my first whack at the chemo. But they had me come back because what they're trying to do is ensure that it's cleaned out at the molecular level, like every single molecule is like resolved. So it took a year for my blood levels to get back to normal after the chemo. And so I had to be very careful. So I wore gloves, I wore a mask and whatnot. So it was a long process, but I feel like my training as a long distance runner served me well.
Yeah.
You know, being able to sort of see the end line, so to speak, knowing that it will end at some point. But I will say that probably the most profound part of the whole thing were the visitors.
Oh, yeah, I was going to ask you what kind of support you had with the whole process.
Yeah, Jana was amazing. She was the most incredible partner, one, because there was all of these things, plant-based diet. She was coming in and making these incredible blueberry smoothies, bringing them in every morning, filled with all these different supplements and amazing stuff. I mean, it was just, it was great to get a visit from her every day.
Mm-hmm.
My mother was coming in two or three times a week. She was driving in an hour outside the city of Boston to visit me. My best friend Jim was visiting me. He lived right down the road from me. And then I had family, relatives I hadn't seen in years. Actually, co-workers from the Yankee Candle Company from 25 years ago. My first supervisor showed up with his family. They came and visited me.
Did Jana reach out to all those people?
She did. Like, she actually had a group of 5 volunteers that she got together, and they reached out to almost, it was 997 people.
You know a lot of people.
It was amazing. I mean, getting kind of choked up, but I mean, I think that that was the most inspiring part for me, because it's really about the communities in your life that make the biggest difference. And it was really, for me, I really feel like this was a gift of having a wake-up call. Like, instead of just thinking like you don't have a lot of friends, like recognizing you have an amazing amount of friends, and you really got to open your heart up to be open to having that all come in, all that love and affection and people just wanting to be with you.
Were you open to that, or were you, I mean, I know some people are like, you know, I don't want the help, I can take care of it all by myself.
Well, it was really intriguing because I got coaching from the nurses, and the nurses were like, you really got to share with people and talk about this. Mm-hmm. And so I took that on with gusto, and I think a lot of that had to do with the fact that I just had a very loving family growing up. And it's hard because it feels, there were times when I felt like this was all about me and I didn't want it to be all about me. I wanted it to have people get like they're part of the story. Like, this is huge for me, but the healing really starts with them showing up. So I was really committed, like they felt empowered coming to visit me. Hmm. So I really wanted to acknowledge the crap out of them when they showed up. Mm-hmm. So like it took energy from me, and I will say that after a visit, I mean, I was exhausted. But it was like a good exhaustion. Mm-hmm. Like I felt like totally spent. It's kind of like, you know, running a great run during the day and you feel great afterwards, but you're totally wiped out. Or it's like you're doing something that you love, but at the end you're just exhausted at the end of the day, but it was like the exhaustion that you want. So
So there's people that are watching right now as you're talking about this, because there's some people that like, I don't have family that's local. You know, they're about 200 miles away. You know, if something were to happen and they're not right here. You know, I don't want people that are watching to be like, well, I don't have that, you know. But there's several ways of community that you were talking about either. Like, community is not just family.
It's not just family. There's friends, there's old work communities, like people I hadn't talked to in 20 years.
Yeah.
I had Deerfield Academy classmates who were getting in touch with me, and these were guys I did not even know, which was amazing in the sense that they knew, I knew of them, they knew of me, mm-hmm. but I began to develop friendships with these guys at a time, you know, 40 years after graduating from Deerfield, and that for me was so juicy and fantastic, you know, to all of a sudden know there were guys living in Boston that it was just great to be connected with them, even though they may have different political views from me. I mean, they were showing up for me. You know, there's one guy who's totally opposite ends of the spectrum politically from me, and he showed up and he spent 2 hours with me at the hospital, you know, and I was just so inspired by that.
I feel like you just never know the impact that you have on other people and being open to accepting that help.
It's
which is
huge.
Hard for some people, but you're right. It's huge because when you accept that that can come in to you and see, I mean, you know, you're lit up to see.
Yeah.
And it had an impact. I mean, we'll get to the next, but you know, the impact of that with your treatment of the frame of mind that you're in because you have all that support, because you don't feel like you're alone, because you have, you know, literally, as you said, almost 1,000 people that were there to help.
Yeah.
But it's, you know, there are people around you that you might not think that you're connected to.
Yeah.
And that's, I mean, that's one big crux of why I do this too. It's like, you know, you're not on your own.
Right.
You might think you are, but you're really not. Like, people are connected. And you, like you said, someone that you went to school with however long ago that you think that you're a blip on the radar, where you could have done something that you're not even aware that you did that caused that person to then be in your life at a time that was really difficult for you.
Yeah, it's so true. I mean, for you're sharing this, and what I'm present to is like we think of ourselves as separate. We have a brain, we have a body, we have this bag of bones, we got this thing we call ourselves, and we think we're separate. And I think it's an illusion that we live like we're separate from others. Mm-hmm. And when you discover the communities, and I think that when we say we're alone, I think we forget that we still have a mother and a father. Somewhere, some way, somehow, no matter what the dynamics of that relationship is, but we are related. We are related in some way, shape, or form. And for me, discovering the relationships in my life was just a huge gift. I mean, it was a huge gift, and it was like a huge healing process. Now, we all have different modalities and different things that we take on for healing. Mm-hmm. You know, I always, one of the things that I took on was like there's this inner healing core that's always there. I would think we shared earlier about that there's, that sounds kind of woo-woo, the inner healing core, but you know.
It was woo-woo, the more, I mean, I spent hours talking to you because it did sound woo, and I'm like, I don't, you know, between your and Jana's stories, I'm like, I don't want to come across being cynical.
Yeah.
But I need to understand too, because
of course.
There's certain things out there that you don't understand. There's, you know, people are cynical about, not cynical, skeptical is a better word, I guess. Just out of not understanding, and you can't understand because you're not in your shoes. Everyone has their own path. But, you know, and being open to hearing stuff, and like what I'm pulling from you is, you might think that you're alone, but nobody truly is alone. There's somebody there.
Yeah.
And that web, you know, like the ripple effect, you know, it does grow into things that you have no idea. You have no idea about.
One thing I forgot to share was that Beth Israel offers Reiki.
Really?
They offer Reiki for all their patients. Mm. So I took it, you know, and I had done Reiki before. I thought it was a bunch of crap. I really did.
Yeah.
But I took it on in the hospital, and it was mind-blowing. I mean, I was stunned at how energized I felt afterwards.
Yeah.
My sister flew in from Seattle, and she spent 10 days. They put a cot bed in my hospital room, and she lived with me for 10 days in the hospital. It's the most time that we had spent together since we were little kids.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, she's teaching Kundalini yoga, which is all about breathing.
Yeah.
And so one of the things is you get interrupted every 3 hours in the hospital, no matter what the time of the day or night is. And so I get woken up 3 times every night. And so I would be lying there, and all of a sudden I would hear, "Are you up?" Like, "Yeah, it's my sister." She's like, "Okay, we're going to do breath of fire." I'm like, "What? What?" So she'd have me sit on the bed, and I'd be doing this.
Like you're in labor.
Exactly. For like 20 seconds, and I'd be wiped out, like just completely wiped out. And she's like, "Okay, good, you can go back to sleep now."
That's funny.
So, but I mean, it was things like that, just the interactions, doing that kind of work, everything. It's just very inspiring. And it's my story.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm aware that, you know, everybody has their own unique story. Everybody has a different way that healing works for them.
Mm-hmm.
And there's so many different modalities out there. I mean, I've mentioned all these things that we do, but I'm well aware that, you know, there are some people that eat meat-based diets that they can heal. Maybe a little bit more work, not as efficient, but I mean, irrespective of that, people heal. It's just a question of discovering that inner healing core that's always there. When you cut your finger, the body heals itself,
mm-hmm.
and we just have to find ways to activate that. You know, there's deep mysteries that science still hasn't figured out. The parasympathetic nervous system, the sympathetic nervous system, the intrinsic nervous system. These are all systems that they have a lot of questions to try and find out about that. But I mean, I'm learning more and more about it myself.
And it sounds like they are too, from, you know, working together as a team. So where's your path now with all of this?
So I have a website, danieljunkins.com. I've got a blog, so I've been blogging. And so I'm just writing and wanting to speak about my story and just leave people with like some germs of hope and inspiration that they can discover their own story or find themselves in their own communities and activate their own inner healing core in some way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's a great way to start off. You know, start brand new in
2020.
I just like to say 2020 all the time.
Isn't it great? I've had two other friends.
It just seems like so long ago.
I know.
Like, I mean, I won't say how old I am. People can figure that out. But when you scroll through, you plug in your date, and you have to scroll. Okay, there's my year.
Yeah.
It just seems, you know, sort of weird that I thought 2000 was weird, but 2020 just seems weirder.
Yeah.
But I mean, but to open it up as to, you know, you don't know what's going to happen. And
right.
Oh, before I forget, I almost forgot. Your rock.
Oh.
Because you had mentioned about, like, you know, the uncertainty of life, the uncertainty of my artistic skills. But I'll empower myself because like it looks somewhat like water. So here's my
God,
water.
I love that.
Because you were on a boat, working on a boat, and you mentioned about diving into uncertainty, you know?
Oh my God.
You don't know what things are gonna be in your path, and you dove into it, and you had this team of support, and you're sharing that, you know, people aren't alone, and to, you know, to treasure the communities that you have. So there you go.
Thank you so, so much. Wow.
Don't throw it at me after we go there.
It's the rock of ages. Thank you. That's
awesome.
Thank
you, Dan. Thank you so much for being here and sharing all of this. And it's a great peppy way to get, you know, it's funny to say peppy. I mean, we're talking about some big things here, but I mean, you're lit up just, you know, talking about this and sharing it.
Yeah.
So, I see the message that you're sending to other people, and I hope, you know, those of you that are watching, you know, life is just uncertain. You don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. And, you know, you need to just take that and just have courage and knowing nothing, really, and just diving right into it and, you know, moving forward with passion to create a life that you want, that inspires you. And I hope today's episode was inspiring for you, and you could check out Dan's website and listen to his blog and hear more about his path as he goes forward. Thank you so much for watching, and we will see you next time. Bye-bye.